and welcome to my tutorial. In our today's tutorial, we'll be learning about each and every lesson that has to be studied in data entry operation subject for NIOS, which is these lessons one by one for grade 10 and for grade 12. We will be focusing on the important points or the key important points which are very necessary for your examination, which is conducted every year in the month of April, May and also in the month of October, November. But from this year, due to the pandemic reasons, the examination would be conducted in July and August for the secondary and senior secondary, which was for the last April, and then obviously the October exam will remain normal as it is going to be. So if you have any doubts related to this one, you can also comment on my YouTube channel and ask me. Same time, you can send a message also. And thirdly, you can also use the resource of our lessons through this lesson projector, which I'm teaching you, so that it will be very easy for you to understand what it is and what not in terms of grade 10 and grade 12. Basically, senior secondary, which is grade 12, has total of 1 to 10 chapters, whereas grade 10 has only 9 chapters, which is 1 to 9. Our data entry operation code is 336 for senior secondary, and for grade 10 it is 229. So one by one we will go to our today's lesson. So the first lesson that we will be studying today is the basics of computer. Now, in this lesson of basics of computer, we are going to focus on what is a computer language, basically, then how it is the functioning of a computer languages, input, process, output, the whole basic scenario of it, okay, and same time many other input and output devices or peripheral devices we need to pay focus also. So let us move forward to our first definition. What is a computer? As we can see over here, the introduction, you can just simply read it out, no need. Objective, you can also skip it, and if you want, you can go through, otherwise no problem, because whatever I'll be teaching you in this video is basically based on all the objectives only. So basically, our question is, what is the computer? So you just need to know the definition of computer, because most probably one mark question will come in the exam. So computer is a device that transforms data into meaningful information. Okay, that is the definition only. What is a computer? It is a device that transforms data into meaningful information. Now, what could be data? Data could be any type of text, number, date, time, age, weight, height, any etc. Any type of information in numerical or text, both of them together means data. Fine. So that is why it is mentioned over here. Data can be anything, that is even the marks that you obtained in the subjects. Also, name, age, weight, height, etc. Now, basically, the confusion that takes place for the student is over here, as you can pay attention. What it is, a computer can accept data. What is the function? Basically, in the examination, they might ask you what is the function, what is the operation. No need to worry, you can just write one time only one thing. Either you can just do this one, can you please scroll down? So basically you can just pay attention to this one or this one, hold out here. You can just pay attention over here, which is accept data, store data, process data as desired, retrieve the stored data, and even when required or also print the result. This is the function. So if you learn this five functions of computer, what does it function do? So basically it accepts data, it stores data, it processes data as desired or whenever required, it retrieves the stored data, and finally it prints the result. So this is the operation. Same thing we have learnt in detail down in this diagram. As you can see in here, when we scroll down, that the computer organization, can you please scroll down? Computer organizational chart. This chart you can see here, we have something called as, yeah, little more, thank you. So here what do you see? Input, output. The whole thing is a processor, because this whole thing takes place inside the CPU, right? So basically input, output, and the whole thing taking place in your processor. So this is the memory unit, this is the arithmetic logic unit, and this is the control unit. So basically what happens, the data which is put or input into the system, into the CPU, it needs to go through different types of things. Either it goes through arithmetic logic unit in order to do mathematical or scientific calculations, or it goes to the memory unit whenever you want to save or store any type of data. But whenever you want to retrieve it or to make any type of function, it is the main thing, that is the control unit, who tells us what it is. So it is the main thing, which is the one which shows you exactly what is happening, and later you see the result in the form of output. The output could be any printer, that is a printed sheet, or on the monitor screen you see the result in front of you. A very simple example is just like in the calculator, if you put 5 plus 1, answer is 6. The answer that comes, the reflection answer is 6. So when you put the input value 5 plus 1 in the thing, this is you doing inputting. When it has to do the arithmetic or calculation, the calculator uses arithmetic logic unit and calculates the value. Finally, you get the answer as 6. That is the output, that is the result. Okay. Now, coming back to the what I told before, that is the operations here. In terms of operation, yes, we have the 5 important operations of accepting data, storing data, retrieving and so on. These 5 are then confused with the second part, which is below this diagram. As you scroll down over here, you can see below the diagram there is operation. If you can scroll down, please. More. Yeah. As you scroll down right below the diagram in your same book, you could find this area, which is the third line, or the starting from the second line in the last. That is the 5 major operations of the function. The 5 major operations. So 5 major operations and 5 functions. They both are exactly the same. So either you can choose any one way to write. It makes no difference because the function is the same. It accepts data as input. It stores data. Okay. Then it processes the data as required or whenever needed. Then it gives the result in the form of an output. And finally, it controls the operation inside the computer. So if you want, you can write this 5. Or you can write the 5 function. Even if the word come a function or operation, no problem. Write the one which you find easy. This one, 2 line, write all the 5 things, or the one which is above the diagram. Okay. Now, what we will do in detail, one by one, let us check the 5 important things. Input, go to the next page. Input is the process of entering data into the system. Then down, go to the starting of this page, little here. As you can see, then we have our control unit. Control unit is CU, which is the process of input, output and processing and storage is performed under the supervision of a control unit called, or a unit called control unit. So control unit is a place in a computer where input, output, processing and storage, everything is performed. Then you have something called as memory unit. Memory unit is a place where the data is stored in your computer. Arithmetic logic unit, also known as ALU. Over here, the major operations are addition, subtraction, multiplication and division, or other anything, or even logic and comparison is performed over there. Correct. Then output. Output is the process of producing results from what we had entered into the system. So basically, when in the exam, if they ask you what is a computer, you write a definition. It's a process by which the data is transformed into meaningful information. Simple. Then they will tell you to draw the block diagram. You will draw the first block diagram with that input, process, output, and inside the process you are having control unit, arithmetic logic unit and memory unit, right? And then you are having the 5 each of those components, which is the 5 things mentioned or explained or defined in detail. How, what is a control unit, what is an input, what is an output, what is an ALU, or what is a memory unit or arithmetic logic unit. Clear? Now, let's move forward to the next page. As we keep moving down, 1 minute, before the in-text question, on the top, you can just make little top. Here you can see the arithmetic logic unit along with the control unit. These 2 important things, the ALU and CU together, that is control unit with arithmetic logic unit, makes the brain of the computer. And this brain of the computer system is called CPU, which means central processing unit. Important question, it might come as match the following for grade 10th, or it can also come as true and false. Whereas for grade 12, it can come as fill in the blanks or true and false. Clear? Then, in-text question you can automatically solve. All the answers are there behind the booklet also. And if you're downloading the booklet on the NIOS website, there also you can easily find the answers at the back of every lesson as per the each in-text question. For terminal questions, if you don't have the answer, you can contact me and I can give you the answers for that. Moving forward to the next page and to the next unit on this part. Peripheral devices. So, basically what are peripheral devices? If you study about peri is a word which means surrounding or outside. So very simple, peripheral devices are devices which are externally attached to the computer system. Externally, not inside the computer, outside the computer. It is not just a screen in front of you which will be known as a computer. A computer is called complete computer system only when a computer has a screen, a CPU, a printer, a speaker, a keyboard and a mouse. When these external devices are joined together, then we confirm it to say as peripheral devices. Now, some of these devices have the function to act as input, whereas some of these devices have the function to act as output. It all depends on how we are using it. That is the reason we have divided in this category the devices into two, that is input and output. Let us focus on the input devices, moving to the next page. Now, in the input devices, the first input devices, as you can see this picture also in here, we have told you that all the external devices that is attached to the computer is called as peripheral devices. So moving forward to different types of input devices down, we can go and see. We have a list of input devices and the definition here. Let us focus on the definition and the list. Little more down, one step, that's it. So here, input devices accept data and instructions from the user. Bus, you don't have to study more than that. So this is the one definition which is more than enough to define, because in the exam they might ask you define input devices and state or explain any three or four input devices. So by this you will be able to define an input device by saying input devices accept data and instruction from the user, where and the types of input devices are keyboard, mouse, light pen, optical magnetic scanner, touch screen, microphone for voice and input, and same time trackball. Now, learning each one of them is also going to be a little bit tricky for your people. So let us only highlight the important points to study for input devices and same time just remember them so that you can easily explain it in your own words and you don't have to waste time, because most probably the answers for this question will be only for, the marks will be only for 2 marks, or it is going to be either for 1 mark. Okay, so let us come forward and see how the first definition for each one of them starts. So the first thing is keyboard. Now, in keyboard, just remember it's an input device, obviously, so because we are learning about input devices right now. So keyboard is an input device. You have to study here which keyboard are we using. So basically, you can see here it's written QWERTY, QWERTY. We use the QWERTY keyboard. The QWERTY keyboard is the keyboard which is used for typing in the computer system. Then, it has how many keys? 104 keys, 104 keys. These are the only three things that you need to remember. That's it. So keyboard is an input device which allows us to type the information in the system. A keyboard is used that is called QWERTY keyboard and it consists of 104 keys. That's it. No need to study more. So much in detail. No need. Move to the next input device. The next input device over here is going to be our mouse, I guess. Yes. So as per the mouse, as we can see over here, it is an electromechanical handheld device. Bus, no need to learn more. An electromechanical handheld device. Its function is to be used as a pointer. Its function is to use as a point, because basically whenever we want to point out at anything, we point using our finger. Similarly, in a computer screen, we power point out using the help of a mouse. At olden times, mouse were used with a ball inside so that the ball used to easily move around the surface and can be used. Nowadays, we have a light which is fixed below it, and the light helps in the movement to go left and right, so the cursor is told, like cursor is actually instructed whether to go left, right, up or down. Okay, and nowadays we have wireless mouse also which is available, and these type of wireless mouses such as these, as we can see. This is a type of a wireless mouse which works only on the basis of a chip. So this chip you actually fit into the CPU and then you can use your wireless mouse, and it also consists a light behind. Alright, now as you can see, I can just switch on also if it works. Yes, so there's the light which comes up. So basically you can see this red light in here. So this red light is available in these type of mouses also, which are with wire or without the wire. Only difference is that we don't have the ball system anymore. Now, so what is the function of mouse? So the definition of mouse? Mouse is an electromechanical handheld device. It is used as a pointer. And then different types of functions are there. For example, selecting, resizing, choosing or moving. For that function basically we use. Moving forward to the next input device. No need to study this whole paragraph. Skip it. Move to the next slide. Light pen. Now, what is a light pen? An input device which is light, utilizes a light sensitive detector to select objects to display on the screen. That's it. No need to study anything more in detail. Most probably it comes very less, because they ask you to define of your own wish any input or output devices. But then if it comes in the exam, how to define it? Just first 2 lines, which is an input device. Of course, it's an input device that utilizes, which means it uses a light sensitive detector, a light sensitive detector to select objects on the screen, just like your pen. Nowadays we have, So basically, as I told you, we have Samsung Note 3, Samsung Note 1, all these mobiles or any type of mobile which uses a pen. Okay, so all this type, the way how a pen functions on the screen of your mobile phone or your smartphone, similarly is the same method this pen is used to select items on the screen. Okay, so basically we can use just like a touch screen, but the thing is it uses a pen rather than using a direct touch of your finger. Then moving forward to the next input device, which is the optical scanner. As we move forward over here, the optical scanner is nothing but a normal scanner which is used to scan images, you know. So basically we can see on the next page, actually, or top, just little up, it's on the next page. Yeah, we can see on the scanner over here that basically more. Yes, yeah. Can you just bring it on the left side? Yeah. So on the scanner, basically, it is an optical scanner, and it has the short form of OCR. And then in the in-text question also, they have asked you this question. In the exam also, it keeps on coming in the match the following and in true and false, that what is the full form of OCR? It is actually optical character recognition, not optical character reader. It is an optical scanner which looks like a normal scanner. It scans images, it scans text, and it then puts it into the computer, monitor screen. So basically, it is an input device because it will take in the information and show you that information on the screen, whether you want to edit it, send it by email to anyone, or you want to store it over there to save it. It is all depending on what you want to do later. But the first step that it takes in the system is just like copying it in the form of scanning, and this is an input device. Now, nothing to more to study in this thing. Just remember, it's an input device used to scan images and text. And thirdly, the full form OCR, optical character recognition. Moving forward to the second last one, which is touch screen. Touch screen, very common. Mobile phones nowadays, smart screen, everybody has this thing. Even some screens back in for some machines and all, even ATM machines nowadays uses the touch screen, which doesn't use a pen like the light detector over there. We just use our finger and we touch and we select the option. Same definitions you can write for mouse and light pen also here. It is nothing but it is a display pad. Display pad used for selecting, resizing, or choosing any icons on the screen. That's it. Then moving forward to the next one. So the next one, Kendra, we have here trackball. So sorry, microphone. So first we have microphone, then we have trackball. So microphone is nothing but it's an input device which takes in sound or takes in voice, and then we can hear it later. So we have two types of microphone. One is the handheld, the one which you can hold in the hand, and another one is the desktop which you keep on the desk. Example, handheld can be used for singing, and the desktop one is for giving important announcement at airports or railway stations. So these are two types of input devices, which is the two type of microphones in the form of input device to take in voice and make you hear. That's it. Now, trackball, same function as mouse. But very important thing to remember over here, that is the difference between trackball and mouse. Why? Because they will ask you to differentiate between a trackball and a mouse. The very important thing over here is that there is no special difference. It is just that the mouse and this both have the same function. Both are used for selecting, resizing, and moving on the screen. But the difference is a normal mouse would take more space while you're dealing. For example, if this is a mouse, and then this is your surface. When you keep the mouse on the surface, it needs more space for the movement, right? But whereas when you're using a trackball, the system remains where it is. It is a ball which is on the top that moves. So basically, your fingers on it are moving. Your fingers on it are moving to go up, down, left, right. You're not moving the whole thing. Whereas in mouse, we have to move the whole thing and I need more space. Whereas for this one, which is a trackball, only the ball is used for moving left, right, up and down. The whole thing doesn't move. So it takes less space. So this is one of the good advantage of this thing. Secondly, we can say it is mostly used for gaming. Mostly used for gaming system also, because it helps in many good things over here by playing games. So these were the 7 input devices. Now let's move forward to the output devices. Now, in output devices, we are learning 4 categories over here, which is monitor, printers, plotters, and speakers. Now, Monitors, please remember one more definition here, one full form, VDU, visual display unit. This question is keep on and on there. They have been asking in the match the following or in true and false that what is the full form of VDU. So it is nothing but visual display unit. An example of visual display units are monitors, and then we are learning the types of monitors on the next page. Then we have printers, plotters and speakers. Let us come forward to monitor. So what is a monitor? So basically, a monitor is nothing but a screen which shows the output result of anything. Okay, anything that you have input, you're going to see it as an output. So when we move down on the next page, we don't learn, we just learn one thing over here, that a monitor is connected to the CPU. That's it. Monitor is connected to the CPU. So that whatever functioning or processing is taking place inside the CPU, it can be seen on the monitor screen. We have two types of monitor, CRT and LCD. CRT, cathode ray tube, LCD, liquid crystal display. Difference, because this difference might come, differentiate between CRT and differentiate between LCD. Cathode ray tube is nothing but the olden type of computer system which used like the desktop TV box like computer, this screen, you remember? And its main function, it used to function in the way that it uses a large vacuum tube called the cathode ray tube. Till date, we still have people who have been using the cathode ray screen, especially inside the hospitals. We can see in the form of our ECG, the heart rate, that machine which is used is the form of cathode ray tube. So basically what happens over here is nothing but a cathode ray tube, full form is CRT. And then we have, what does it do? It uses the, it is the olden desktop system or computer, and it has what, just like a television, it works the same way, uses large vacuum tube. So the last line is important, uses a large vacuum tube called the cathode ray tube to display the screen. LCD, liquid crystal display, found in every mobile phones, obviously these are LCD, our TVs nowadays, the flat screens, you know, the TFT panels, including the laptop screen, all these are examples of liquid crystal display or LCD screens. What is the difference in cathode ray in that? LCD can provide a better resolution, a better picture quality than compared to cathode ray tube. Second thing, it takes less space compared to even our cathode ray, because cathode ray will take up a large space due to its vacuum ray tube present inside, whereas LCD requires only a limited space due to its thinness compared to CRT. Moving forward down to the next part, printer. Now basically we are learning, printer is nothing but an device, an output device that gives you hard copy of the material that you need. It gives you the hard copy of the printer, or hard copy or a printout of what you want to see. Okay, and we have four types of printer here, and for each four type of printer we will learn just one line or two lines maximum in as a definition. The first printer is a laser printer. Now we are having four printers here, laser printer, inkjet, dot matrix and line. We are learning first about the laser printer. If we go down, we will see over here that laser printer, what is it? It prints a high quality printout, extremely fast and with easy automatic paper loading. So what does it do? This is a printer, laser printer. It has an automatic system of loading the paper. Means we put the paper at the first, as much as its capacity is to accept. After that, whenever we put a print command, it continuously takes the paper inside, gives the printout. Takes the paper, it has automatic. We don't have to put every time one by one paper, no. If we just put one bunch of paper inside as per its capacity, and it keeps on and on taking the paper whenever the printout is, command of printout is given, so that it can print accordingly. Now talking about it, it's very fast. It can be used both for color and for black and white. Thirdly, it has an automatic loading system. Then you need to learn about the number of pages it can print in terms of color and black and white per minute. So it prints out 200 pages per minute in black and white and 100 pages per minute for color. That's it. No need to study more. Second thing is inkjet printer. An inkjet printer is a printer automatically in your book. You can see with the picture that an eye photo is printed over here, but you don't have to concentrate on the eye. Basically, you need to understand by this, that is, it is used for printing photographs. Reason? Because of its good printing or the spraying of ink technology. Now, it is consisting of what? An inkjet printer is a printer which is used actually to print images on the paper. That's it. An inkjet printer is a printer which is used actually to print images on the print pages. Okay, it has 64 tiny nozzles. Remember, 64 tiny nozzles. And what is the tiny nozzle? A spray like small holes, nozzles are present inside, which sprays ink. This spraying of ink causes the image to be seen in a very good printed form, in a good quality. That's it. No need to study more. Moving forward to the next printer over here. As we move down in the next printer, which is our dot matrix printer. A dot matrix printer is the olden type of a printer which was used. The only issue is that it is not expensive. It is completely inexpensive, but makes a lot of noise. Okay. And secondly, since it makes a lot of noise, it has a lower quality. We usually use it for printing bills and receipts. Okay. And it is the measurement of its speed is in the base of characters per second. This question will come in as match the following or true and false. What is the speed for dot matrix printer? It is measured in character per second. So basically, what is the definition? A dot matrix printer is a printer which prints low quality printouts, usually used for bills and receipts. Number one. Number two, we can say it is completely inexpensive. And number three, it is measured, the speed is measured in characters per second. Moving forward to the next printer, which is the line printer. Line printer also some of the type of printer which is like having rolls and bundles of paper moving in it. You can see over here, rolls and bundles of paper are taken and it is printed out. It is literally slow in size, okay? But like this, the speed is ranging somewhere between 100 to 300, 3800 lines per minute. And same time, the quality depends was not that much high, but as time passed, the quality trying to become more better and better. So when you have large type of receipts or somewhere to be printed out, we actually use this type of printer for so having a complete one big printout for something. Secondly, it's expensive. That is why it costs lakhs of rupees in order to purchase it. So lakhs of rupees. So here what we can say, the 3 points. Line printer is a printer used for printing or data processing for a long paper. Number two, it prints 100 to 3800 lines per minute. Number three, it is expensive, which is can charge you in lakhs. But moving forward to the next part, which is the next output device, plotter. We have finished with monitors, we have finished with the printers. Now we are learning plotter. What is a plotter actually? A plotter is nothing but it's a device, okay, which is used like a printer to produce images on paper. Now, we just learned this part, the first 1.5 line. A plotter is a special kind of an output device, just like a printer, to produce images. Now, which images we will produce? Basically, we produce the blueprints of any construction site used basically in engineering. For maps or blueprints of any designs, maps or interior decorations, we prepare it using the blueprint, and that is the reason we have it using the help of this called plotter. Now, basically, as you can see, you're producing large drawings or images. That's it, you don't have to study more. Now, moving forward to the next part here down, there are two types of plotters, flat and bed. Now, flat bed and drum. These are the two types of plotter. Flat bed and drum plotter. The flat bed and flat bed and drum plotter, both of them uses of course rolls of paper, but in the first one, flat bed, you don't have to use you cannot use a big roll of paper because of its small size and it can be fitted anywhere. Whereas for drum plotter, it's a bigger size, okay, so it prints more higher and you can put rolls of paper in that. So what are the difference between the two? The drum takes more space on the system compared to flat. Okay. Number two, in flat, the disadvantage is we cannot use big roll of paper. So we have to keep on adding papers, whereas in this one drum, we can just put at one time the whole roll of paper and have a continuous printout without any interruption. Moving forward to the last output device, which is the speaker. As we all know, what we use in the input device for speaking, which is the mic, to hear what we have spoken clearly, we have an inbuilt system called the speaker. So a speaker is a device, an output device, which makes us listen to the voice, song or any multimedia clips recording. Again, I repeat, voice, sound or any multimedia clip recording, it makes us hear that one. Clear? So this is the 4 output devices only and 7 input devices that we have studied. Together, input and output devices are known as peripheral devices. Moving forward to the next part here. The next part is actually the in-text question, so we will not consider that. You can solve it yourself and you already have the answers there. Go down. Software. Now, since we have learned what is the function of a computer and the need for it, we have learned about what are the input and output devices also. Now it is our time to study what is a software, basically how it functions. Every system of a computer is made up of 2 things, that is called software and hardware. things that we can touch are called hardware and things we can only see are called software. So all these programs that run in your system are known as software, and all the things which we use externally like keyboard, mouse, CDs, flash drive, all these are our hardware. So in software, we basically need to learn what is the definition. So first we need to study what is program, then what is software. So basically, the sets of instructions are called programs. So basically, we give the set of instructions. We need to make a particular instructions, a list of what to do and what not to do. This list is then converted in a form called program. Okay. And these programs, so basically software set refer to a set of programs that makes the hardware perform a particular set of tasks in a particular order. So if I didn't make the program, the software doesn't know what to do. So group of instructions is called programs. And different programs joined together will make one software. And this software actually tells the hardware what to do. For example, if a mouse is there, which is connected to the computer, a mouse, a wireless or a wired mouse, both are in hardware object, right? In a hardware device. So this hardware, how does the computer know that when I move my mouse on the left, it has to go to the left? When I move to the right, it has to go to the right. How does it know? Because of the inbuilt software. So the software already has a set of programs, a set of instructions which tells the computer when the movement of the mouse is seen moving right to left, you need to move the cursor to the left from right. So this is the set of instructions. If we go to the subcategories, we can see down the table or the flowchart given to us about the programs. The software is divided into two categories called system software and application software. The system software is further classified into operating system and utilities, whereas application software is further classified into generalized packages and customized packages. So basically these two packages join together in order to make us understand what is the divisions or subcategories of software. Let us learn one by one each of them in detail. The first thing of the software that we are studying is the system software. So basically from the word itself we can define it, that system software, the software of the system. Every system that you purchase, that is a laptop, a complete desktop or a CPU, all of it consists of something called as software or a system software. For example, if you are using an Android mobile, the software that it is using is going to be Android, which is the operating system. Similarly, Apple is having Macintosh and then we are having Windows, which is Microsoft, which is using Windows over there. So same thing we have here, that the system software is further classified into two categories called operating system and utilities. What is the definition of system software? So as we see the definition here, system softwares are nothing but the set of programs responsible for running the computer. So basically, you know, something that is responsible, how will your computer switch on? Your computer switches on, shows you the things happening, the Windows screen appears, the start button appears. All this takes place just because we have something called as the system software. If we did not have the system software, the computer wouldn't have switched on from any angle. Same thing, when this computer switches on, it switches on with the help of a particular software. And what is that software? That is the operating system called as OS. If we move forward down, we can see over here that example of some popular system, Unix, Windows, Linux, all these are examples of operating system that we use. What are utilities? Utilities is nothing but, as we just read over here quickly, utility programs are a broad category of software such as compress, zip, compress or unzip file software, antivirus software, split and other join files. So utilities is nothing but other things that helps our operating system to function. Basically, there are some inbuilt, to say it in a very easy language, we can say there are inbuilt programs, right? So these inbuilt programs in our system is actually called the utilities, okay, which we don't delete, such as camera, part of utility, antivirus system, part of utility, file management system, Windows Explorer, part of utility. So all these things which help the operating system to function together to make your computer work properly are called utilities. Okay, so you just say, we get some simple definition, are programs with broad category software such as compress, zip, unzip, which helps as an extra additional part with the operating system. This was the definition for system software and operating system utilities. Now moving forward to the second subcategory, which was application software. What is an application software? An application software is a set of programs which are written to perform specific tasks. special programs made to perform specific tasks. For example, if you download any app in your mobile, let's take an example because mobile phones are also computers, so all example resembles the same. If you download, for example, scanner in your mobile, so by mobile cam scanner, the function is what? Why was that scanner invented? To make the function of scanning. Similarly, anything that is made, any application, any software which is made to do a specific task, for example, doing the task of typing, doing the task of creating presentation, doing the scanning, playing games, all these are application softwares, okay? Example here is given library information system. So when you're working in a library, for example, you would require a library information system where you have all the record books of all the books that you have in your library, along with the people who have borrowed it, with the codes and their particular ID and details, so that you can just call back or get back to them whenever the book is not given or returned on time. So that library information system is a type of an application which you will make it for specific tasks by yourself. Okay, you can use any type of thing to make it. One basic common example to make it is using Microsoft Access. Then, another example of application software, we have now the two categories, which is, as we go down here, it is going to be generalized package and customized package. So generalized and customized package are the two packages which are the subcategories of our application software. If we move more forward down, as we can see here, this generalized package is nothing but it comes in the form of word processing, spreadsheet, already present in your system. Besides Microsoft Office, Microsoft Office is a complete thing which has Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Access, Publisher, OneNote, everything. Whereas this one is just the basics, which is word processing and spreadsheet. Okay. And if I talk to you about customized package, this was generalized. Customized is some application that you made by yourself. For example, you made the application or library management system. If we move forward down, and we can see over here, after the example of generalized package, just we can move down. We can see that there is a customized package over here. In customized package, more down, customized package, we can see application which we have made by ourselves. More down. Full. Yeah. So student information detail, payroll packages, inventory control, all these are application or common application that we have made in order to make our specific task to be completed. That is the way we use application software in the form of customized package. So basically, what did you study? You studied the software. There are two types of software for the graduate into two parts, system software and application software. System software is responsible for the running of the system and application software is done for the specific task. System software have two categories, operating system and utilities, whereas application software two categories, generalized package is already part of the system like spreadsheet and word processing, whereas customized package what we can make by ourselves to any application for the functioning of our any task. Okay, now last but not the least, the end of the lesson, which is computer languages. So basically, what is computer language? You all understand the computer is born to a particular type of a language. 1 minute here. This is called syntax. A computer is a machine language and it will only understand a machine language in the form of binary digits, zeros and ones. It cannot understand what we say. We all come from different parts of the world speaking in different types of languages. And computer at one time cannot recognize all those languages because these languages are in the form of machine languages they need, and ours is high level language. They need different type of help to convert our high level languages into their type of language, which is machine language. Let us learn one by one in detail what does this mean. As we all know, our computer is born to a system called syntax of language, and syntax means a special type of a coding or method through which the computer uses to understand. It cannot understand our simple language like Hindi, English, etc. So what it prepared, it divided the languages were later divided into two parts, as we can see here. Can we move down? Computer language was further classified into two categories, low level language and high level languages. So low level languages are languages which is very closeness to the way in which a machine understands. The very closest way a machine can understand is called low level language. So we have two types of languages, low level and high level. First, let us learn the low level language. A low level language is a language which is very close to the machine language. It is further classified into two categories, machine language and assembly language. So what is the definition of machine? Because the exam, the question will come, write a short note on computer languages. So basically, you will just talk about computer languages based on or born to something called a syntax. Then this computer language are further classified into two categories, low level and high level. Under low level, we have machine and assembly. What is the definition of machine language? A machine language is language is the form of zeros and ones called binary digits. Enough. Assembly language, it is a type of a language in which the machine, where the machine codes zeros and ones and substitute it by symbolic codes called mnemonics. So basically, machine language are languages which is in the form of zeros and ones called binary digits, whereas assembly languages are the languages which can do what? They code the comprising, which they code the binary digits, the zeros and ones into symbolic, they substitute it into symbolic codes called mnemonics, bus. That's it. This is the only thing you need to know. Now moving forward to high level language. A high level language is a language with an extensive knowledge hardware, obviously, which is our language. So that our language in the computer, what happens when we type in any language, the computer takes up that language, converts it into machine language, and then gives us the result back into our language, the one which we expect in. So if I wrote an information in English, computer converts that English language into a low level language of binary digits or mnemonics, and then makes it understand, gives us the result, and in the final result that we see on the computer screen is back in our language in which we were typing or in which we had input the data. Now, high level languages are of five types. The first one is basic. Just remember the five types and names and what is it used for. So the high level languages, for first example of high level language, basic definition is beginners, all purpose, symbolic instructional code. So basically beginners, all-purpose symbolic instructional code. This is the example that you should know as the full form of basic. Okay, that's it. Nothing else you need to know. Then, second type of language that we are going to be having this COBOL, which is common business-oriented language. Enough. No need to learn definition. More. Then we have up. Then we are having Fortran. Fortran. We have Fortran. Fortran is the formula translation. More up, my dear. Yes. Yeah. Fortran, formula translation, and then C, which is structured programming language, and C++, popular object-oriented programming language. So basically, we have five types of high-level language. Basic, COBOL, Fortran, C, C++. This one. Fill in the blanks. Sorry, fill in the blanks. True and false, or match the following. They might give you wrong answer. C++. It is popular object oriented. Remember the full form C++ and C. C is structured programming language and C++ is popular object oriented programming language. So all this full form you need to know. Fortran, formula translation. COBOL, common business oriented language, and basic, business all purpose symbolic instructional code. Now, finally, the last part, compiler and assembler. So what is the function compiler and assembler? It's a very easy type of thing. So if you just go down, we can just see here. As you know, the high level language machine is independent, and assembly language through its machine yet dependent mnemonics that are being used to represent instructions and not directly understandable by the machine. So basically, whatever we write into the system or what the system looks from us is not understandable in a very clear way. That is the reason, what do? We have to have a converter fixed inside. These converters are in the form of compiler and assembler. So compiler and assemblers are required to convert these instructions into machine language. Otherwise, the machine will never understand what we wanted to explain. So what is the definition of compiler and assembler? Very simple. A set of program or a software that reads a program written in high level language and translates it to equivalent or machine language. Bas. The object or the set of software that converts high level language into machine language is called compiler. If you're not comfortable with this definition, I will give you another tip which will be more easy. Let's move forward to the definition of assembly language. Now, you can see here this diagram before assembly. They can see this diagram here. Source program, compiler, object program, machine language, high level language. So it's very simple that if you draw this diagram for the 1 mark or 2 marks to differentiate between compiler and assembler, you can actually make your own definition looking at this diagram, which is very simple, that the source program is taken by the compiler, converted into object program. In short, we can say the high level language, which is the source program, the high level language, which is the source program, is taken by the compiler, converted and then translated into object program or machine language. Same thing happens with the assembler. What happens in the assembler diagram? We can just see over here on the next page that the machine, the assembly language, which is again the source program. So basically the source program or the assembly language is taken by the assembler, converted by the assembler and given the result or translated into object program, which is back again into machine language. By just drawing these two diagrams and explaining what you did here would give you full marks to differentiate between a compiler and an assembler, because in general you know both compilers and assemblers are used to convert the normal high level languages into machine language. So by drawing this thing, you'll be able to understand this completely. Moving forward to the next part, again we have an in-text question. After the in-text question that you can solve by yourself, we have what you have learned and terminal question. Now, one small important thing which is towards the last, which is for grade 12. Till here, this was the portion for grade 10. In the same lesson, before learning software, there is a memory system to be learned for this one. Memory system for grade 12 senior secondary. So for this memory system, basically you have it in your textbook grade 12. So basically what is the memory system over here? We will just learn it in a very clean screen. Can you just move down to this little blank screen, my dear? Just move down, more. Somewhere more down, full down. I need a blank screen. Can you make it blank? White blank screen. Yes, perfect. Just go little up. In here, we will just learn that we have two system in memory system. We have two memory system, primary and secondary. Okay, so we have two memory systems in computer, which is called primary and secondary. Okay. Now, as per primary and secondary, the primary memory is called RAM, which is called as random access memory. Whereas secondary, we have ROM, which is called read only memory. So we have two types of memory system in computer system, primary and secondary. The primary is RAM, which is random access memory, and the secondary is ROM, which is read only memory. Difference between them, the RAM is a temporary type of memory. When the electricity goes off or when the computer shuts down, whatever stored data in primary gets lost, disappeared. Whereas in secondary, we have devices to save the memory, such as USB, CD-ROMs, flash, etc., DVDs, etc., okay, or hard disk, all these places. So this is the memory system. So there are two types of memory systems in computer system, RAM and ROM, according to primary and secondary. The primary is called RAM because of random access memory, and it gets deleted. It is never temporary, never permanent. It's a temporary type of storage. Whereas secondary is a permanent storage because in the form of ROM, read-only memory, where you can save it in flash drive, CD-ROM, USB and DVDs. Only this is the important part in grade chapter number 1 for grade 12 senior secondary. Before that, what I have thought is both 10 and 12 both should know about this thing. Okay, so this was our lesson today on basics of computer. Hope that you have understood, and if you have any doubts, you can just ask me through a YouTube channel and put a comment over there, and let's move forward for the next lesson that will come for and uploading over there. Thank you. That I will stop. No problem. कितना तो